02749.
Hook up.
All around the globe, fighting planes and fighting airmen have become the symbol of a new age dawning on the world, the age of the air. In less than 5 years, there's arisen a generation of flyers who look to the sky not only as a battlefield for today, but as a lifelong peacetime career. In every industrial country, aircraft construction has multiplied to figures believed impossible before the war. Behind the scenes, science has equipped the human body to explore those upper layers of the atmosphere where hitherto no man could live. Research has perfected systems of aerial navigation so ingenious as to render visual contact with the ground almost unnecessary. From the atolls of the Pacific to equatorial Africa, the United Nations have girdled the surface of the Earth with a gigantic belt of landing fields, aerial transport bases forming the crossroads and the terminals of a global system of military supply. Between these bases, Great Britain, Canada, and other allied nations have spun a web of air communication, linking their centers of war production with the far-off battlefronts. But today, the principal air carrier among the Allied powers, the nation operating the largest number of military transport planes over the longest routes, is the United States. To speed the passage of men and equipment to the fighting fronts, the U.S. has set up through its Air Transport Command a troop and cargo carrying service which spans 5 continents and 4 oceans. Even before the war, many of these flyers were experienced airline pilots. Now they know the long transoceanic routes to Dakar and Khartoum, to Karachi and Kunming, as well as they once knew the run from Chicago to New York. These great planes, sweeping down to the jungle runways with their loads of munitions and medicines, staff officers and special personnel, have convinced air-minded people everywhere that the wartime supply routes of today are pointing the way to the global skyways of tomorrow. In 100 forms, the challenge of this new era is even now upon us. A challenge to our capacity to plan the coming air age so that its benefits shall serve the peaceful interests of all. Within a few years of the war's end, no one on this earth will be more than 3 days distant from your local airport. Already, permission has actually been sought to bridge the Atlantic with floating sea drones. Already, aerial freight trains can reduce thousands of miles of space to a few flight hours. but statesmen are warning that the splendid opportunities of global flight can also become the occasion of rivalry between great powers, each seeking to establish its own air routes for purposes of national prestige. They are remembering how after the last war, certain states used the privilege of flying over foreign territory to engage in espionage and military preparation. And they are saying that to prevent future conflict in the air, it will be necessary for the nations, even before the war ends, to find a common code of operation to which every state will agree to subscribe. Already in Washington, America's leaders are discussing what policy the United States shall recommend for the governance of the coming air world. They are recalling the enterprise of one trip, whose giant Pan-American Airways system did so much before the war to further America's commerce with Europe, Asia, and her neighbors to the south. They know that since the start of World War II, their country's military needs have dictated the construction of immense numbers of transport planes and airports. And with such potential peacetime strength available, it is believed that some U.S. opinion may favor an international agreement which would allow the airlines of every nation free access to the whole world sky. Equally interested in the planning of the air future is Great Britain. With her huge aircraft industry devoted to the production of combat planes unsuitable for commercial use, Britain may find herself less favorably placed than some other nations for immediate post-war flying. Relatively few of her superb Royal Air Force personnel have been wartime transport pilots. To many of them, one route only is familiar, the bombing route to Germany. At the same time, Britain's bitter war experience might well lead her to call for careful control of the post-war skies. But the British, too, are well aware of the opportunities of long-range flight. They remember the vital task performed before the war by British Overseas Airways, their government's chosen instrument for linking the distant nations of the Commonwealth. But what if countries along these routes should, in years to come, raise diplomatic barriers to the passage of aircraft? To prevent a stalemate such as this, Britain may well propose that the skyways be regulated by a worldwide international authority. Already, Britain's engineers are drawing up her post-war plans. Already, her new transports are under test, heralding her intention to claim her share in the coming air world. Meanwhile, observers of the world air scene are watching that northernmost quarter of the Earth, which is the home of two air-minded nations, the Soviet Union and her neighbor, Canada. For many years before the war, these two nations were pioneering the far north against the time when new forms of transportation would allow them to develop the resources of their Arctic regions. In the 1930s, that time came when Canada began the opening of her Northland by air. Soon her aviators were carrying mail and supplies to whole cities standing on the northern tundra. We're looking down upon the once deserted spaces of the subarctic, where now surveyors and prospectors, themselves landed from the air, were planning still further stages of the northward march. Down to the very shores of the Arctic Ocean, they blazed their trails, hauling in materials and machinery for new townships in the building. And it was partly the daring of these civilian pilots that made possible the great military developments of today in the Northwest and Alaska. At the same time, Russia's air routes were pushing north beyond the furthest limits of the land towards the pole. It was here, at the natural junction of three continents, that her scientists and airmen proved that the frozen regions of the world were no barrier to planes and men properly equipped for polar flight. And only a few weeks later, a Soviet plane, its motors sounding across the polar ice, across the summit of the Earth itself, made a non-stop flight, reported as easy and uneventful, from Moscow, Russia, to Portland, Oregon. And returning home, the pilot said, I believe the new world and the old will soon be joined across the pole. And so our whole conception of the world we live in changes. For in this new era of flight, the old-fashioned flap maps of our school days will no longer present a true picture of the Earth. Henceforth, we shall have to see our planet as the airman sees it, as a globe. And looking at the new air map, we see that in the northern half of this globe are 9/10 of the world's people, most of its largest cities. And they say that the Americas will soon be joined to Europe and to Asia by aerial trade routes crossing Canada, crossing the pole, crossing the spaces of Siberia, all in a few flight hours. As the world lifts its commerce to the skies, the people everywhere will see the greatest opportunity the age of flight can bring as the opportunity for states and nations to order the traffic of clouds so that all shall have a fair share in a truly international system dedicated to the common interest of mankind. Only with this assurance can the airmen of today gaze upon the frontiers vanishing beneath their wings in the certainty that along the global air routes of tomorrow lies a great adventure of peace.